Greetings! I am Herbert Erpaderp, and today I'm going to see what I can do with these ruined church parts made by Italeri. I found these pretty cheap in the hobby shop, so I figured, why not? There isn't really much of anything on the back of the box, just a few examples of other kits made by Italeri. These models are 1/35th scale, so they're definitely not correct for a bolt-action scenery piece which uses 1/56th scale. But I figure churches can be pretty big and grand buildings, so I'm going to use them anyway. Who's going to stop me? Are you? Didn't think so. Let's see what's inside the box. I have to admit, I was a little bit disappointed when I opened these boxes. Not because they're bad models or anything like that, in fact, they're quite neatly molded and fairly nicely detailed without much in the way of mold lines. Unfortunately though, they're single-sided. The backs are hollow and not detailed at all like I was expecting. If the box showed this, I definitely would not have bought them. I guess they are intended for use as display pieces, kind of like a movie set. You are only meant to look at them from the front. This obviously would not do for a terrain piece which needs to be three-dimensional. Obviously, I could just give up on the project, but giving up that easily is for chuds. While I ponder on how to deal with this problem, I set up the pieces and see how they will fit on my intended base. I'm going to use an MDF placemat as a base. It measures 290mm by 210mm. These are great for little dioramas and bases for scenery pieces. You can get these, as well as a few other shapes and sizes, in the craft section of the local hardware store, or at least you can here. I would imagine they're not uncommon in hardware or craft stores elsewhere. I roughly mark out where I think I will place each part. The good thing about MDF is you can easily draw on it with a pencil, or I guess a pen if you want. Great for remembering where you want to place your items. Your plans can easily be erased or drawn over again, or ignored. I did change my mind quite a few times over the course of this project just how I want the walls to be positioned. There are a few good options. I then quickly clean up the sprue gate remnants and any flash I could find. There isn't really much, so this step doesn't take very long at all, and then it's time to give this model an interior. I am going to do this in two ways. First, I'm going to cast some of the parts in resin. To do that, I need to make a mold, and that's messy. To make the work surface a little bit more portable and easily cleaned, I put the MDF base into a plastic document protecting sleeve thingy. It fits perfectly and it's easily disposed of. I choose the parts I want to replicate. I'm mostly interested in the door frame area and the window. I position them such that I can get all the areas I'm interested in into one mold and not have to make separate molds for all three pieces. I figure this might save a little bit of the silicon. To stop the mold making silicon from just flowing everywhere, I build little walls with plasticine. They don't have to be perfect, or even neat. All they need to do is stop the silicon from flowing away. If you really want, you could use a sculpting tool to make all the edges nice and perfect, but I'm not that anal. The good thing about doing this with plasticine is that you can keep reusing it, and it's fun to play with. Lego is also good for making mold boxes too, though it's a little bit less flexible. You should end up with something that looks a little bit like this. The plasticine in the window and door gaps is just an attempt to save a little bit of the silicon. It's not pretty, but it should work. The only way to find out if it does work is by pouring the silicon in. I'm using Pinky Sill, which is made by Barnes and I believe is a fairly common product and isn't overly expensive, though still not something I like to waste. It's a two-part product that is mixed in equal parts. I just pour it fairly slowly into the mold. I started with the areas that were of the most interest to me, just to be sure the Pinky Sill settled into those areas as smoothly as possible. You can see here there's a fair bit of lighter pink and even some white in the Pinky Sill. It should all be one uniform colour. You have to stir it properly before it begins to set, which I don't believe I did. I should have used a better stirrer. It does set pretty quickly, so I was trying to be quick and I made a mistake. That's okay, that's how we learn, and maybe you won't make that mistake now. The mold should work just fine anyway. Most of the improperly mixed Pinky Sill was on the bottom of the mold. It just took a while to dry and some of the spots did stay a little bit sticky. They are probably still sticky. Oh well, let's remove the plasticine and plastic parts and see what kind of result we got. The Pinky Sill did leak under the plastic parts a little bit, but that's okay, we can just use a knife to cut that and free the pieces quite easily. I think I got a fairly decent result here. Because I didn't completely surround all the parts with Pinky Sill, we will need to use a little bit of the plasticine again to make more dams. Just like before, they don't need to be too neat at all. We are now ready to pour some resin into the molds. Unfortunately, I didn't manage to film myself actually pouring the resin, and I did do it twice. I did it twice so I would have plenty of extra chunks of rock that would look like they came from the walls that I could use in piles of rubble. The resin sets pretty quickly, though it does get hot, so you should try to avoid spilling it on yourself in your haste. It was still warm when I removed it from the mold. I think I got a reasonable result. Of course, these are quite damaged walls, so they don't have to be too perfect. I cast one door and window set quite thinly so they would better fit the inside of the plastic parts without needing too much work or protruding inwards too far. It will obviously still need a little bit of trimming and filling, but it looks like it will fit pretty well. So I used super glue and glued that part into place, being careful to get it as neatly aligned as possible. The door section was a little bit more tricky. I didn't want to keep it bricked up, mostly because I couldn't figure out a way to cast the brick pattern in reverse, but also because the bricks make it look abandoned before it was destroyed, and I don't really want that look. I think it will look better and provide more gaming fun with a nice open doorway. So to achieve this, I removed the bricks using a lot of snipping, scoring, hacking, and snapping. I tried to keep the brick patterned part intact. Into my bits box it goes. I'm sure it will be useful some other time. I then guessed where the cast door part needs to be cut in order to fit properly onto the back of the plastic part. Nothing too tricky went on there, though I did manage to crack the part when I was cutting it. Not a big deal, but it's something you should be careful of when working with resin. It can snap easily. When I was satisfied with the fit of the part, I superglued it into place. Next, I need to figure out what to do about the very obvious hollowness these walls have. It's not very realistic. I obviously need to fill these holes. Green stuff would definitely work, and we are going to be using some green stuff, but not now. We need to use something cheaper to fill the majority of this space. I had some of these cork saucepan mat things laying around. These were very cheap for a pack of three, and they can be used to make some pretty convincing rock with little effort. Because they're so cheap, they can also be used as a filler. As luck would have it, they're just about the perfect thickness for what I want. Now we don't have to use more of the relatively expensive putty than we really need to. Doing this is quite simple. Just roughly cut chunks of the cork to sizes that will fit inside the wall parts. I superglued the cork in using a cheap tube of superglue because I had it on hand and didn't feel like using the more expensive zapper gap for this. This didn't take long at all to do. Don't these walls just look lovely? As an added bonus to using the cork, the leftover chunks can be used later as debris and rubble around the church or on other projects. So don't throw it out, put it in a bag and keep it. I spent a while pondering over assembling these wall sections before applying putty. Gluing them together in advance means I know exactly where the joins are and won't have to remove anything if I accidentally sculpt something over a join point. So I joined the wall parts together. Because we're only bonding the plastic parts and none of the cork or resin, plastic cement will work perfectly well for this. The only downside really is that now I can no longer choose different configurations for the wall parts. Not really a big deal. I probably should have done this prior to gluing the wall sections together, but I filed down some of the edges around the door and window just to neaten them up a little bit before I start with the putty. I then used Milliput. I know I said I was going to use green stuff. I lied. I've had this box of Milliput laying around for a very long time, and I figure I might as well use it. It comes in these big logs, so I find it harder to mix the tiny amounts I normally would with green stuff, which leads to a lot of wastage, so I don't often bother using it. It is good stuff though. I go fairly slowly with my application of Milliput. I mixed up relatively small batches of it at a time and worked on a small section of wall at a time. I then let that section dry before I begin another. This is so that I don't accidentally destroy a completed area while working on another. I gradually fill all the gaps and cover all the cork. No need to rush this. I use a very wet finger to smooth the surface when I feel as though I have all the putty in the right place. It is then time to rough up the destroyed edges of the wall. This is a little tool I made myself for creating textures.
The texture bot 4000!
Okay, so it is of course just some rocks glued to a piece of cork, but you can make some interesting textures with something simple like this. The way I use this little tool is simple. Just press it into the areas that need to be textured. No need to be particularly careful or gentle about it. We want the texture to appear fairly random. Of course, if you're not satisfied with the result, there's no reason you can't just smooth it over and try again. Even just partially smoothing it over and redoing the effect can have interesting and nice results. It is a bit hard to see owing to the bright light and light color of the material, but so far it's looking all right. Next, I quickly removed any of the Milliput that may have gotten into the mortar lines in the resin stonework. We don't really want smooth walls. Then I created more mortar lines in the smoothed putty surface. I tried to do this as carefully as I could. I made an effort to try and match my sculpted lines with those on the exterior surface of the model. This is really quite straightforward and not exactly the most complex or demanding type of sculpting work. This is the result I ended up with. It is pretty rough. I am definitely not the best sculptor in the world, nor even a particularly good one, but this is fine for what I want. You could spend hours trying to get nice straight lines, but it didn't matter a whole lot to me. You can see the corner where I've omitted the putty. I'm going to make a pile of rubble here, partly to add some interest and partly as a nice raised area where snipers might sit in the window or look out the gap between the two sections of wall. I figured it would be a waste to put putty here and sculpt in the stonework. You can see here where I have marked out some spots on the floor. I'm going to add some floor tiles in these little sections just to add a little bit of interest to the rubble and debris within the church. I spread out the milliput roughly in the areas I marked out on the base. I do this fairly thinly because I didn't really have much left. Also, it doesn't need to be very thick anyway. I then smooth out the area with some very wet fingers. This will get rid of any fingerprints and other odd marks. I then took a sculpting tool with a knife-shaped end and cut some lines into the milliput. The intent here was to create large flat slabs of rock and not nice neat floor tiles, which is why I went for such an irregular shape. I was tempted to use the cobblestone roller from Green Stuff World that I had a look at a while ago, but I figured the cobblestones it produces would look too small at this scale. I wanted nice big floor stones, not little cobbles. I wasn't entirely satisfied with the result I got. These gaps were a bit too narrow, so I smoothed it over partially and redid the lines with a slightly wider tool, the pointy one. I remove any little clumps of putty that accumulate on the end of the tool. It can come off the tool in places you don't want it and make a mess. I more or less just traced the first lot of lines I carved, only wider. I felt the bigger gaps would make the floor stones more obvious. I want them to stand out from the rubble a fair bit. They'll probably be a slightly different colour to the walls and rubble too. The entire process was quick and very easy. Here's the result I got. Much like the walls, they're fairly rough and nowhere near perfect, but for my purposes, that's just fine. There are still some gaps between the resin and plastic pieces, so I will need to fill those in. Because I've used all my milliput, I'm actually going to have to use green stuff. It's pretty simple and quick. Just put the green stuff into any gaps you need filled, smooth it out either with your fingers or a tool, and that's about it. I actually find the green stuff a little bit more pleasant to work with. It doesn't seem to want to stick to fingers and tools nearly as persistently as the milliput does. And with that, I have completed all the sculpting for this model, I hope. It certainly is looking very colourful indeed. I then glue the wall sections into place with super glue. I did ponder on this for a little while. It might be easier to paint the walls before gluing them down, but it would be easier to match the rubble up with the walls seamlessly if I glue the walls in before painting. There are pros and cons. In this case, I decided that gluing the walls down now was a better option. Plus, the base gives a convenient holding handle for painting. You might find it helps to hold the wall parts down while the glue sets up properly. Now to make some rubble. It's a bit hard to tell because of how bright and white they are, but the white things are chunks of the resin castings I made. I'm going to mix them in with the rubble. It should create a more realistic look that is more consistent with what the building's walls look like, I hope. Better than a simple pile of gravel anyway. Before I start with that though, I'm going to use some more of the cork as a filler here in the sniper corner. These are just roughly cut scraps piled up and super glued together to make the basic shape I want the pile to be. Mostly built up in one corner with a short ramp shape down towards the floor. It doesn't have to be too neat. I figured I might as well do a little bit of experimentation with the rubble. I'm going to concoct a rubble mixture using this Tamiya diorama texture paint that I've had sitting around for years. Some fairly small rocks from Back to Basics, and some fine model railway ballast that was probably intended for N-scale, though the bag has long since lost any label it might have had. I'm also going to include a couple of chunks of the cork we used to fill the walls for a bit of variety. I always find that cork enhances the taste of my rubble mixtures. The cork should end up looking like big chunks of rock that are flat on some sides. I started by adding a generous portion of the sand texture paint. It is quite thick. Then add quite a few rocks and stir. Add more rocks to taste as you feel the need. At this point, I also decided to add some of the cork. Stir it all together to get the paint to coat everything nicely. Then I added some of the ballast and stirred it through. The result was this thick, goopy muck. It kind of looks more like some weird cement than rubble, but that should change as we go. The way I applied this rubble mixture was just to sort of glop it onto the areas that I wanted rubble to be. It didn't quite handle how I had hoped it would, and it was a lot more sticky than I had anticipated. It had a tendency to stick to the popsicle sticks that I was using to apply it, which was a little bit annoying. I found it pretty hard to get into all the areas I wanted it to be in, at least in a satisfying way. But hey, that's why we experiment. Next time I will probably try something a little bit different. I did eventually get the mixture largely where I wanted it. I started using two popsicle sticks to scrape the mixture off each other and onto the model. You can see it kind of looks like a really gross version of scrambled eggs or something. Gritty. Once the mixture was in place, I sprinkled some of the bigger rocks all over the mixture, just to be sure that the rubble wouldn't all look like rocks buried in sand. It was my hope that the texture paint shrinks significantly. I followed this with a sprinkling of the ballast. I also squished down any rounded edges that might give the rubble more of a beading liquid look than that of a pile of dirt and rock. Next, I cut some rectangular blocks of cork. I cut these roughly the same size as the stones on the outside of the walls. I glue a few of these around the outside of the church. In my imagination, the church mostly fell inwards when it was destroyed, but it does make sense that a few of the chunks of stone would have landed outside. The reality is that I ran out of rubble mixture before I got to the outside and couldn't be bothered to make more. I like my little inward collapsing story better. The chunks of stone on the outside will mostly be surrounded by grass, which should hopefully make them look a little bit more realistic. I then finished it off with a coat of Vallejo Black Surface Primer just so everything is ready for painting, which will be sometime kind of soon. I do have other projects that I want to work on first. I'm fairly satisfied with how this has turned out. I will admit that I wasn't so pleased with it until I primed it. I guess that brought everything together and made it all look reasonably consistent. I think it's going to look quite good when I get around to painting it and adding things like grass, bushes, and dirt. It's not the most perfect model when you look at it up close, and it is only one corner of a destroyed church that kind of just stops, but that's okay. Nobody is likely to care too much in a game of bolt action, or you can just place it in a corner and say that the rest of the ruins are off the board. Either way, it should provide a good solid place for infantry to hide, with plenty of space for them to shoot out of or potentially be shot through themselves. Plenty of wall for them to be hiding behind. You could place a sniper here on the pile of rubble in the corner and have him either look through the gap in the wall or the window, and he should be fairly hard for enemies to see. You can fit smaller tanks through the gap here, like this Sherman made by Rubicon. Click here if you want to see me build this tank. A link will also be in the description below. It might not work so well for something wide like a tiger, at least physically, but we can always make exceptions and allow or disallow that kind of thing. I guess it depends on what the players decide. This should be a fun and variable piece of terrain, and I'm excited to get onto painting it, but like I said, other projects first, including a certain Junkers dive bomber. I guess that gives me time to ponder on the sorts of colours that I want to paint this thing with. It's definitely not a good idea to use model paints for this. Might have to see about spraying artist acrylics through the airbrush. I'm sure Mel the Terrain Tutor will have some videos about this. I'll be seeing what I can learn from him. I do suggest you check out his channel, The Terrain Tutor, if you're interested in terrain at all. You can learn a lot from Mel. A link is in the description. And even if you don't check his stuff out, I'm sure I will be able to pass on whatever I learned there to you when I eventually get around to painting this church ruin. Initially, I did buy these little kits with the intention of making wargaming terrain with them, but then I figured that I could also use them for their intended purpose of being display pieces, especially if I use it to display this, a 1/35th scale KV-2, or, well, any tank in that scale, but a KV-2 is what I have. Not only will it make me happy to see it on my shelf, but it eliminates the problem of where to store it. Not having a lot of storage space, this is good. It's much better to have the model nice and visible than packed away in a box that you have to dig out when it's time for a game. So now my model has two purposes, a very large ruined church for bolt action and an average-sized ruined church to act as a home for a lurking KV-2, which really could use some paint. One day. This kit was really a lot more work than I had anticipated when I bought the two Italeri Church ruin kits. Had I known that they were one-sided, I probably wouldn't have bought them, at least not with the intention of making gaming scenery. However, I think this build goes to show that just because a kit is designed a certain way for whatever purpose doesn't mean you have to actually build it that way, and you can repurpose it for whatever your heart desires. That's one of the great things about modeling. You can do what you want. It's also not especially hard to create new parts of a model with putty like milliput or green stuff. At least parts like a rock wall that are all broken and damaged and such. And casting with resin can be pretty simple too. I hope I have demonstrated that. So far, I'm still not 100% thrilled with my rubble, but I am happier with it now that it has dried and shrunk a bit. It should look a lot better with paint and maybe some little bits of grass sticking up out of it or something. What matters is that it gets the message across that this is rubble. What do you think? I would love to hear any comments, questions, or suggestions in the comments section below, especially if you have interesting or new ideas about rubble that I could try. I do hope you've found this video helpful or interesting. If you enjoy the videos I make, it would be a great help if you shared them with your friends, enemies, and anyone that might also find them helpful. Also, it would be most excellent if you subscribe to this channel as well as my original Herbert Erpiderp channel. A link to that is in the description. And of course, if you really like what I do, please consider supporting me via Patreon at patreon.com/herbertherpiderp. It would be greatly appreciated. A link to Patreon is in the description as well as the end card here. Stick around for more videos soon. Thanks for watching. Farewell.